Welcome to the BioBalance HealthCast, episode number 339, a discussion of neuroimaging and the news that it brings for treatment of depression.
BioBalance HealthCast features conversations about positive aging. Your hosts are Dr. Kathy Maupin, Medical Director of BioBalance Health and a leading expert in treating symptoms of aging, and Brett Newcomb, a licensed professional counselor. Dr. Maupin and Brett are the authors of The Secret Female Hormone, the seminal work about hormone replacement therapy for women, which is available on Amazon or from Dr. Maupin's office at BioBalance Health. Dr. Maupin's office is currently accepting new patients.
Depression is one of the most disturbing illnesses to have, because if you are clinically depressed, nobody knows what to do with you in your surround. And after a while, nobody can stand you. They don't want to do anything with you because you have no energy. You don't think quickly. You don't respond. You don't want to do anything. You can't do anything. And there doesn't appear to be anything wrong with you. And so people that suffer from clinical depression suffer doubly, because they have their own issues of depression, and then they have their relational issues because their support environment becomes very non-supportive after a while. So treatments for depression vary. There are a lot of things that people can do. They get counseling, they get medicines, they get testosterone replacement. They do all kinds of things that have varying degrees of return for what you do, of success. But it's a difficult topic. There's news in the science field, medical science field, about things we're learning about recognizing and potentially being able to treat certain kinds of depression. What they have begun to learn is to identify the region of the brain that through what is called neuroimaging, they do MRIs of your brain, or they do an fMRI, functional MRI of your brain, which the difference being when they do an fMRI, they're actually watching your brain function. They're watching it at the time that something is happening to see where in the brain the activity spurt occurs. So they are now able to correlate certain regions of the brain with certain types of depression. And that's fascinating, because that means they can learn to target the different antidepressant medicines, because some of them work on one region of the brain or the other. But we didn't know that. We just knew that you take it. If you come to me and you're clinically depressed, and I say, well, because I can't prescribe, you have to go see a physician and they have to prescribe you an antidepressant. So you go to your doctor and they say, well, I've had a lot of luck using Lexapro.
Right.
So we'll give you Lexapro. It'll take you 11 to 13 days before you start to feel anything. And it may take as much as a month before we really know if it's going to do what we need it to do. And if it's not, then it'll take a couple of weeks to come off of it, get it out of your system, and then we'll give you another one. And we just have to rotate through them, because there's no way to know which one is best.
Well, you know, depression, I mean, when I first learned about depression, I mean, we always have had depression to treat with medicines, but the medicines in the before 1980 something were very they had lots of side effects. They were they made people miserable yet not depressed. You had to MAO inhibitors, you had to watch
diet
your
issues,
foods,
cheese, soda,
things that you couldn't eat if you were on
chocolate,
that medication. But basically depression was one nebulous thing. Then once we got the serotonin reuptake inhibitors,
SSRIs,
then, you know, like Lexapro, I mean, Wellbutrin's partially that. There's several different, or many, Prozac was the first one, different medications. We found that, by golly, it's not one thing. It's not like, you know, low thyroid, I replace thyroid.
Right.
So it's not that. It's not replacing your serotonin or increasing it. Everybody's got a different type of depression. They've now honed it down to four what they call biotypes of depression, which means you're missing a neurotransmitter it's malfunctioning, or it's not working properly in a certain part of your brain. So every depression, when you look at it under an MRI, which is the magnetic, it's not X-ray, it's magnetic resonation, that you look at to see what the function is, these four types will be divided up, and we can actually divide depression into four types, which we can see on an X-ray like we would for like lung disease or heart disease or abdominal disease. We can take a picture of it and say, oh, this medicine will work. So we have now finally divided depression into four types with four different types of medication that will work for patients, mm-hmm. which is a huge change, and not one that you're going to see in your doctor's office immediately because insurance won't pay for it. When new ideas come, they're not going to pay for an MRI. It's still in the
experimental
stage, but at least we know it's possible, and we're working toward that.
Right, and over time, they will continue to do the research and then be able to measure which particular antidepressants are working in the areas that need to be worked on mm-hmm. for the type of depression that you have.
Right. They will have, instead of having guidelines, so I look at an MRI, I say, it's type 1. Mm-hmm. I'm going to treat with this. Or if it's type 3, I'm going to treat with this. And then they also have guidelines for counseling. What type of counseling is going to work? Do you need PTSD counseling? Do you need counseling, talk therapy, where you just talk it all out? Do you have to go back to the trauma that you had when you were young?
Right.
And go over and open that wound and get rid of it. Basically, there's different types, which is what you do, many different types of therapy for different types of problems. But depression's always been this kind of big diagnosis. And it seemed that every doctor I know, including myself, would just hand people an antidepressant. Mm-hmm. Here, take this.
Yeah.
Now, in itself wasn't proper because it was just trial and error. We knew what depression looked like when a patient comes in your office. Everything's wrong. They have no affect.
What's fascinating is the evolution, and certainly for me, fascinating in my own thinking uh-huh. and knowledge, but I think for the industry, for the field.
Yeah. It's different.
The increased knowledge about how the brain actually works, mm-hmm. the growth of data from neuroscience and the connectivity of that data to the counseling profession, to learning about. I mean, somebody would come to me that was seriously depressed, and we would do talk therapies. Mm-hmm. And they might help situationally. The research data is always out on that. They say you take the statistically same number of people, some of them just get better over time. Say mm-hmm. 6 months, they're better. Whereas I would say 6 months of therapy helped you get better. Mm-hmm. The data would argue that. Maybe it's just time passing. And in the meantime, all I'm doing is holding your hand. Does that have
but
value?
But that's not how you do counseling.
No.
Brett's counseling is quite different than most people's counseling. Brett's counseling isn't just, how do you feel about that, which I find to be patronizing and not very active. He gives you ideas on how to respond to something or how he's observed that you think. And because you think that way, maybe we should try to respond a different way or think about the situation differently. You know, that's how you frame a situation or how you look at yourself and frame that makes a huge difference in how you feel.
I find that that's true. Not only how you feel, but how you're capable of responding differently. Mm-hmm. You know, there are patterns in all of our lives, and we fall into those patterns. We develop defense mechanisms that work for us, and then we use them. It's like cards that are in your hand. You play the card that you have. Part of the challenge with working with clients clinically is to find out initially, how did you get here? What happened mm-hmm. in your life that brought you to this place? But then my approach is to not spend exorbitant amounts of time re-chewing the old cud. You know, mm-hmm. why do we need to go back over that story 5,000 times? Mm-hmm. We've learned what we need to learn. The question now becomes, how are you going to leave here? How are you going to move forward? What's going to be different? How are you going to manage for something to be different? What do you want to have happen? Mm-hmm. And one of the questions that I would always ask clients when it would come in, if our work together is successful and things improve for you, what's going to be different in your life? How's it going to look? If we have mm-hmm. success, draw me a picture of what success is going to be.
The interesting thing about depression is that I always viewed it like this and explained it to my patients. Before we all knew what depression was,
right.
I would have to explain why I was treating them because I've ruled out your thyroid problems or your menopause or, you know, way back when I was doing gynecology, I'd say, here's what it feels like. And if they were depressed, they go, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It feels like you're in the bottom of a well,
mm-hmm.
and you're looking up. There's no rope. There's no way to climb out.
No hope.
You have no hope. Yeah. You don't even have the energy to climb out. Now, that's obviously probably one type of depression, but that was kind of a general feeling of people who were depressed.
Yeah.
So now we're looking at, what rope do we send down? Do we send down a rope with knots in it? Do we send down a rope, you know, basically a different treatment with that looks like a rope ladder? That's how we get people out of this.
Well, and the interesting part about this article that we're basing this conversation on, the research is done by Dr. Connor Liston, who is a psychiatrist and a neuroscientist at Weill Cornell Medicine in New York City. And he's the one that's written this article and said, hey, you know, we're figuring this stuff out now.
He looks like a baby, too.
He does. Yeah, that's really upsetting.
Yeah, he looks 12, but that's okay. He's brilliant.
When we were discussing it prior to deciding to make a podcast on this, one of the things that I shared is that when you work with clients that are suicidally depressed as a counselor, as a psychologist, therapist, at the severity of their suicidal depression, they don't have the energy to get up and go across the room. If there's a loaded gun laying on the table over there, they don't have the energy to get up and go over there and pick it up. They're sitting in their chair or on their couch or in their bed, and they're saying, I would do that. I will do that. But right now, I'm not going to do that right now. But I'm going to do that. And so they are at risk. When they start to get better, which we have now learned, when their brain chemistry starts to improve, uh-huh. when the medicine is working or the time has passed or their neurotransmitters have reloaded, whatever it is that they're doing, that is when they hit the bottom and they're at the bottom and you're all worried about them, when they start to come up,
uh-huh.
the energy level comes up faster than the mood.
Right.
So that is the maximum point of risk. And the beauty of this information, this new research, is you can graphically measure, you can monitor when that energy level starts to come back uh-huh. to that area of the brain, and then you can have someone be alert, be aware, be supportive, be around,
mm-hmm.
make sure they don't have opportunity,
mm-hmm.
So that you decrease significantly the risk that they'll kill themselves.
That's why antidepressants have on them as a risk suicide, because they make you better, they make you
Better, faster,
enough
physically than you,
emotionally. That you have them, that you view yourself and you go, oh my gosh,
yeah.
it's not worth it.
Right.
But most, I mean, in my mind, anybody who says their own life, I mean, our basic survival instincts counter that, but they say their life isn't worth it.
Yeah.
They're unstable. They're mentally unstable, and we need to take care of them until they get their emotion and brain back, because it's not normal to be a human and want to destroy yourself. That's just not normal. And it's part of depression.
It is part of depression. And again, clinically, people like me have to learn not to panic, not to overreact to that. We have to spend enough time listening to somebody to make an assessment. And there's a scale of lethality. There are questions you ask. How lethal is your suicidal ideation? Do you have a plan? Do you have a means? You're going to hang yourself? Do you have a rope? You're going to cut your wrist? Do you have a knife or a razor blade? No. I'm going to shoot myself. Do you have a gun? Do they know when? Next Thursday night, my parents are going to be gone.
Yeah, see,
and I have a gun.
That's a bad
hidden,
sign.
You know, the more specificity they can bring to what they intend to do, the more at risk they are. But somebody just says, you know, my life is hopeless and I'd be better off dead. And frequently what they'll say is, everyone else would be better if I were dead.
Right.
And so that is not an indication of intense suicidality. That's a message of depression and despair mm-hmm. and mangled relationships mm-hmm. that you can work on.
Because it's easy.
If you don't panic.
Because they view it as the fastest way for relief.
Or they'll say, I'll kill myself and then you'll be sorry.
Right.
You know, you've abused me in so many ways that I can no longer suffer life. And I'll kill myself and then you'll be sorry.
Yeah. It's a way of hurting someone else.
Yeah.
Which is?
Well, it's the ultimate message, and it's selfish. But they don't know it. I mean, they can't see it at that point if they're genuinely depressed.
You know, depression can be physiologic. We can have hormonal, mm-hmm. you know, we see this all the time. People in my practice who have not been depressed their whole lives. In other words, they've been fine mood-wise, and then all
like
of a sudden.
Falling off a cliff.
And all of a sudden, they're 45, and they go, yeah. Oh, my gosh, I don't want to live anymore. Yeah. My favorite is, when I go out to a really nice dinner, I go, is this all there is? The food doesn't taste good. I mean, yeah. really, I mean.
This is what they say to you.
Yes, they say to me, I don't feel like going out for dinner because it doesn't taste good. I'm not happy. I don't, you know, the things that used to bring them joy.
I look around my new car.
Bring them joy anymore.
Yeah.
You know,
exactly.
Even to the point of not tasting good at all. Mm-hmm. You know, it's one of those things you have to ask about. How do you feel when you do your favorite thing? But many times that's chemical. It's always chemical. But sometimes it's caused by our own internal hormones changing, and then that decreases serotonin or decreases epinephrine or dopamine. All three of those make us feel good. Well, so we have to figure out which one is low, which one we can replace, and then we have to have some kind of tool to replace it.
Well, we classify what we call endogenous depression, which is depression that's caused biochemically. Your brain chemicals are out of balance. That's why you are experiencing the symptoms of depression. Exogenous depression is some external event that has happened that causes you to be depressed, like your dog dies.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a natural grief reaction that slides into depression because you miss your dog and mm-hmm. you're upset about that. Or you know, you get a divorce or you lose a job or mm-hmm. some event happens that causes you to be depressed. So they're two totally different kinds of situations. But what we're learning more and more is that even with the exogenously depressed stuff, the reality of the depressive feelings has to do with changes in neurotransmitters.
Right.
And this kind of
chemicals.
Neuroimaging can allow us to learn where that impact is happening in your brain. Mm-hmm. And then we know what that part of the brain does.
Mm-hmm.
And then we can, what Dr. Liston says, is we will be able to learn in the coming months through continuing this research which particular existing medicines focus on that particular area of the brain so we can increase the success levels and the speed of treatment for all these
people. There's one of the four types mm-hmm. that affects the thalamus and the hypothalamus, which uh-huh. is where the first stimulation of our hormones comes from. It goes from the hypothalamus to the pituitary
mm-hmm.
and then from the pituitary to stimulate our glands. So that I would bet, now I have no knowledge about this, but I would bet that that's where the type of depression I see that occurs as we get older, that occurs when our testosterone drops or occurs when our adrenal starts aging and we don't make as much epinephrine. Those two things come from the type of depression that is affecting the thalamus and the hypothalamus. Mm-hmm. That's kind of at the base of your brain. It sends chemicals
kind of
to your pituitary.
Kind of general condition of apathy.
Right.
Yeah. You go from apathy, from being apathetic, to being pathetic.
Yeah, well.
But that's an improvement.
Only for you. So when I talk to people who say, I don't know why I'm depressed. I've been fine my whole life. A woman comes in, I'm 45 years old. Everything's perfect. My kids are in college. They're successful. My husband's doing well. We love each other, blah, blah, blah. But I don't want to do anything. I'm depressed. Now, often, mm-hmm. if there's no trigger,
yeah.
they're already on a depressant, antidepressant when they see me. And I'm looking at their hormones and I'm like, oh my gosh, somebody took your ovaries out. You've got nothing. You know, that triggers the depression, but it's not a situation.
Well, there is a cause for it.
It's a chemical.
And it's not an external cause. It's not the exogenous depression. Nobody betrayed me. I didn't lose my money in the stock market. Nothing mm-hmm. bad happened. But now I have this apathy and depression and lack of energy and I don't know what's going on. Now, you know, we used to say, oh, well, let's dig deeper. There has to be something that's
meaning
something.
This. In your life,
yeah.
not something
in your
that's
body.
Chemical
yes.
in your body. So I deal with this by saying, you know, this is a short-term thing. You haven't been on this very long.
Right.
Now, I'm going to give you your hormones back. When you feel well, this is how I manage it.
Right.
When you feel much better, I want you to go back to the doctor that put you on the antidepressant. And I want you to say, please help me try getting off of this. Because I don't like to mess with, it's not really ethical for me to work with somebody else's drugs that they put the patient on. So my patient, I treat them. And I treat them with hormones for that same thing. And then I ask them to wean off with their other doctor, because that's who put them on the medicine.
Absolutely. You should never mess with an antidepressant by yourself. Do not change your dosage, and do not come off of it because you don't think it's helping or because you feel better.
Certainly
or
not
you.
Cold turkey, because you can have lots of
this under, and you have to take it under a doctor's prescription and supervision. You have to come off of it under a doctor's prescription and supervision. You need not to play. I mean, this is deadly. You can't afford to do that.
And one of the things that happens is if you come off, say I'm giving someone a hormone or an antidepressant, what I'm doing is suppressing their own production, right? So I'm giving somebody basically a reuptake inhibitor that increases their serotonin, and that then decreases how much they make a little bit. So when I stop the medication, there's a huge drop in serotonin and a huge increase in depression if I have not fixed the problem a different way, like giving somebody thyroid or giving somebody testosterone or giving them adrenal hormones so that they aren't, for their Addison's disease. They basically are going to feel worse if I haven't treated them properly to physiologically get them out of their depression. So they need to be watched.
Well, and as we said,
it has to be slow.
It does. And there are so many different kinds of depression. A lot of people that are clinically depressed will have repetitive cycles of deep depression throughout their life. They'll get better, and then they drift down. And it's so insidiously slow that you don't recognize it until suddenly you're sitting in the corner staring at the wall and have no energy.
And you can't go to work.
And you can't do anything.
And you don't engage with your family.
So, again, that's why for people that have that issue in their lives, they need to have support systems. They need to have a physician. Or like in your office, you know, when you work treatment plans for people, your nurses check on them.
Right.
And say, hey, are you doing this? And how's this going? And
we see them every 4 months, so we can go over everything.
If they're not showing up, you find out why not. Mm-hmm. So you need, if those are issues that exist in your life, you need a support system that can recognize when you start to slip and say to you, you need to check back in with your doctor. Or have your doctor call. Say, you know what? It's time for you to come and check back in with us. Because
you can't check yourself. In this circumstance,
it's a miserable way to exist.
You can't look at yourself and say, I'm depressed or I'm not depressed or I need this or I need that. Because it's kind of like being drunk. You can't,
I'm not drunk.
But I mean, it's kind of like being drunk. You're not in control of your own impulses. So you have to have somebody else there to help you and watch you.
Yeah.
And it's not, and I'm really a hands-off kind of doctor. I want to put you on a treatment plan and do everything, that line everything up and have you do it because it's your body and it's your motivation. But in this case, you have to have your psychiatrist or your primary care watching you.
Well,
or your family.
One of the frustrations that my clients would have with me if I was working with them for depression is that I would regularly say to them, you know, part of the challenge here, and I really understand that you don't have the energy to do this, but part of the challenge here is to fake it till you make it. You have to get up and move. You have to do your exercise. You have to go to work. Mm-hmm. You have to go to the grocery store. You have to make yourself do this as much as you can. And they would look at me and say, if I could do that, I wouldn't be here.
You know, right.
Why am I wasting money paying you for that advice? Because I can't do that.
But there's internal motivation.
Yeah.
And then there's external motivation.
Right.
And the external motivation is what you're providing for them, saying, it's possible, you can do it,
support.
Let's go, do it step by step.
Mm-hmm.
Wake up in the morning and put your clothes on for work.
And
take your shower, put
to.
Your clothes on.
Get dressed as
get
if
dressed.
You're going to work. Then sit at the table all day. But at least get up and do that. And
do the first
step. Regularly.
Yeah. Right, and
create
keep
rituals.
Practicing,
mm-hmm.
because that's very important. And then keep doing it till you get there. Mm-hmm. And by then, your antidepressants probably kicked in. So, I mean, that helps. And it gets you moving faster so that you see the positive reinforcement when you look around at your life. Everybody's reacting differently. I don't know. I've had several depressed friends in my life, mostly when I was young. They are so difficult to be around.
They are. They're exhausting.
They just, it's kind of like you just pour yourself out. I mean, just you're empty when it's over and they feel better and walk away.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause they just sap your energy. That's part of what depression does, and it's why people feel so alone when they're depressed. Because after a certain
partly they
period
are,
of time,
people leave them.
Yeah, people go, yeah. Oh, I can't do that anymore. It's so exhausting. I'm protecting myself.
Yeah, you're no fun anymore. I come around here and you just sit and mope and stare at the wall. We don't have fun. We don't have dynamics. We don't have interaction. I'm going to quit coming around.
I honestly feel like people, I mean, I advocate antidepressants, not for every single thing that happens to you, not just like it's water, but for people who are truly depressed.
Yeah.
I advocate using antidepressants and then therapy, talk therapy.
Hallelujah. It is not depression. It is not a characterological defect. You're not broken in some way. It's a physiological anomaly. It doesn't mean that you don't have character, that you don't have will, that you don't have strength.
You're not a bad person. It's
you're
just
not a bad person.
You have an illness.
You didn't do something wrong.
You have an illness like anybody else. If they had the flu, it's not their fault.
But it's not as visible as the flu.
I know.
You know, if I'm sneezing and coughing, you're going to recognize it. If I've broken my leg, I'm in a cast, you're going to give me some sympathy or empathy. If I'm just sitting staring at the wall and I appear to be a healthy, functional person, after a while, you're going to get tired of that and say, you know, screw this, I'm out of here.
It's a lot like hormone imbalance.
It happens to people a lot.
Because people just kind of either act through it so no one knows, or they basically just kind of exit life because they've got this hormone imbalance. So nobody can tell they have that. They just think they're being irritable or unhappy.
Or, you know, same corollary, but same issue. People that are aggressively obese will go on diets all the time, and whenever they talk about food, they say, well, I'm barely eating anything. I don't know why I'm so obese. But typically, I've had clients who struggle with this issue come in, and depression is a big part of it. They would say, I go out to dinner with my friends, and when I go out to dinner, I only order a salad, and I don't eat all of it. I just eat a little bit of it, and my friends are amazed because I don't obviously eat a high volume of food. She says, what they don't know is before I got to the dinner, I stopped and had a whole cake and a dozen donuts. And when I go home from the dinner, I'm going to stop at McDonald's and get two Big Macs.
Right.
So they hide that behavior so that what their friends see causes their friends not to understand why it's a problem.
Well, oftentimes obesity is the outcome of depression because sugar is a drug.
Yeah.
And if you eat carby things, you're treating oftentimes, not always, you're treating not only a hunger, but you're treating a craving from your brain for more serotonin, more epinephrine.
Sure.
So you're feeding your neurotransmitters with that. But what happens is you get kind of immune to it, just like any other drug.
Mm-hmm.
And your body needs more and more, and you just gain more and more weight. So it is sometimes a sign of depression to be obese.
Yeah.
But and antidepressants sometimes make people lose
weight. It's
what we
call comorbid. There's comorbidity. Yes. Just like people have depression, they have anxiety at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
And they suffer from both.
Mm-hmm.
But one masks the other.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, there's a lot to be known and studied still about depression, but it's exciting to hear this news that the neuroimaging and the ability to identify the segments of the brain that respond to the particular antidepressants gives us hope for improved treatment down the road. So keep listening for this kind of information.
Thank you.
Email your questions or comments to podcast@biobalancehealth.com. You can find the BioBalance HealthCast on iTunes and on YouTube. For more information about bioidentical hormone pellet therapy and other reverse aging solutions, visit biobalancehealth.com or call 314-993-0963. You can find Dr. Maupin on Twitter at Dr. Kathy Maupin and on Facebook at facebook.com/biobalancehealth. Find Brett Newcomb at brettnewcomb.com.